Today, we're going to shake things up a bit and talk about a really important topic known as stationarity. I'm not going to give you all the jargon this time around the mathematical concepts around stationarity because we're actually going to build our own asset, asset X, as shown up here on the screen, and we're going to play around with the parameters so that you can understand intuitively what stationarity is. And this will really, really help you understand co-integration, which is in the up-and-coming video. Now, just imagine you're a trader and someone gives you this price chart for asset X over here. And you'd say, well, this is very easy. Whenever the price goes down, I'm going to say buy here and I'm going to sell here. I'm going to buy here and I'm going to sell here and so on and so forth. This would be the easiest thing to trade. And in fact, these sort of patterns don't really exist because if they did, we would all trade them. It's slightly different in pairs trading. For those of you who are pairs traders, you already know where I'm going with this, but we're not talking about pairs trading right now. Right now, I'm just looking at one asset. Again, this asset X over here, and I just want to trade this one asset. Stationarity, and very simply put, weak stationarity, because there's two different types. The one that you will care about and only ever hear about is really referring to weak stationarity. Weak stationarity says, first and foremost, that the average, so let's say I pick this time window over here is the average of this versus say the average of this time window here versus say the average of this time window here or this one over here, they should all be relatively constant. In fact, they should be constant. It's also the same with the variance. So here we can see the up and down movements here, the size of this variance over time. So if I picked again any sample of time here and here and looked at the variance, again, that should be constant over time. And the same with the auto-covariance. So if I compared the covariance between one time step and the prior, say, time step over time, again, that should be constant over time. So what stationarity is really just saying here is that over time, we want all the three major moments in a time series data set to be stationary, to be constant. So you picture a car being stationary, right? It's not moving. When I look at this financial time series over here, I can see that it's not moving really. I mean, it's still, it's stationary. That's what I'm looking for. Now, enough said, let's go and build our own asset. And to do that, I'm going to create a new file here. And let's also talk about very quickly what it is we're going to model. Well, we already know how to model things. In fact, I'm going to write an equation for you here in Excel. I'm going to write it nice and big so that we have something to follow and understand what it is we're building. So we're going to build an asset, we'll call it X, and X at any time T is going to be equal to some constant, right? So we'll call that alpha, so some constant plus, and we'll come up with a coefficient, we'll just call it beta times X sub T. In fact, that'll be at t minus one. So this is now just an auto-regressive model plus some market shock, which we'll call epsilon, and that will be at time t. So this should be familiar to you by now. This is just an auto-regressive model of one, of lags one. So we're looking at x and we're modeling it based on its prior value. So that's what we're going to go and build together here. Now let's put in some constants. I'm going to use alpha and beta. Alpha, I'm going to assign a value of 100. And beta 0.5. And we're going to tweak and play with these numbers soon, so don't worry. Now let's come up with our data. We'll start with X, and so that'll be X at times T. And the first value we give it, in fact, let's make this first cell something like yellow, so I know that that's an input cell. I'm going to give it a price of $200. This next column, I'm going to call our constant, which is alpha. And I'm just going to make that equal to alpha over here. And in fact, I'm going to drag this down now to maybe 360 rows of data. We'll put like nearly a year's worth of data here. I just like the number 360. And there we go. We've got our constant over here. Previously, in order to model our market shock, we calculated based on what we predicted or the model predicted minus what actually happened. We don't have an actually happened. We're building that. We're coming up with our own asset from scratch. And so what we're going to do here is actually model and come up with our own market shock numbers. So here I'm just going to put E, which is our market shock, and we're going to say that this here is just going to be coming from a normal distribution, and it's going to be an inverted number. And in that, what we're going to do is put in a random number. Now, in fact, before I do that, let me just put in this equals rand. When I put in equals rand, every time I change something in Excel, refresh Excel, that number changes. It goes between, I think, 0 and 1. So it comes up with a uniform random number distribution. And so what I want to do is take that and convert it to an actual number based on a Gaussian normal distribution, a bell curve. And so to do that, I can just take the inverse of a normal distribution. That's what this here is going to do. And I'll make it between 0 and 1, just the standard normal distribution. And so that'll make sure that these market shocks vary. They're not just, you know, some fixed market shock distribution. They're actually following the same distribution over time, which is a normal distribution. Fantastic. Now we can say that x is going to be equal to alpha, which we know is this constant value here. We just made it equal to this. So there it is. I put it in a column so it's nice and clear. Alpha plus beta, which is this 0.5 number we entered earlier, multiplied by xt minus 1. So here's the prior time step for t, plus our epsilon sub t. So here's this data point over there. And you can see that number changes every time I make a change because of how this random distribution or this random function works in Excel. There we go. Now let's just go and format all of this. Here I'm going to make it to say 2 decimal places. That's fine. I'll do the same here just so that everything looks nice and neat. Now let's draw this as a graph. So if I come up here and I go insert and I insert a chart, here is our chart. I'm going to move it to the top. Here is our asset X and look at its price. This is wonderful. We can go and trade this. Now, how did I know that doing this, building this model with these parameters here would give me this stationary time series where the mean, and I'm going to prove it to you in a moment, the mean, the variance, and the auto-covariance are pretty much constant over time. Well, the reason I could do it is because of this beta number over here. It's 0.5. Now, I want you to think about this intuitively for a moment. If the current price is equal to, let's just call the constant 0 for now. I know we put it as at 100, but let's just say it's equal to 0. Is equal to 0.5 times the prior price. And that prior price has the prior market shock in it as well. That means that if a market shock happens, so boom, a market shock happens, and that's, say, the only market shock that ever happened, then over time, that market shock will diminish again. And so the price here will revert. And so if these market shocks stopped, which they don't, they continue all the time because they follow their own distribution as we just built over here, then you're going to get something that looks more like this. And in fact, that's exactly here what we've gone and put together. And so for a series to be stationary, it needs to follow some rules. First of all, let me go and change this beta to be something like 0.7. Now, I'm also going to change this constant as well. If I change the constant to 60, it also fixes that graph for me. So you have to play around with the constant to sort of get the graph to look nice for you. So here we go. Our constant is now 60. Our beta is 0.7. You can see that it is still mean reverting. Now, watch what happens if I change this to something like just 1, just the number 1. Boom. You see here that we have this straight line. So all of a sudden, there's no stationary behavior going on now. Granted, again, we need to change this alpha value to something that looks more sensible. I'm going to put it to 0.0001, and that will help fix our graph over here as well. Now, I'm just going to hit F2 and enter to refresh the randomness of our random generator here, which every time I refresh this is now pretty much coming up with what looks to be a completely different asset from the last one. But that's just because of how this calculation works. And I'm going to leave it to randomly generate on every update we make. But here we go. You can see this is no longer stationary. Let's just have a quick look over here. You can see here we have a trend, and then here we have a slight upward trend. This is definitely, if I looked at the average of this versus the average of this, it's not going to be the same. The variance looks to be pretty much constant, actually, except for here we have a big spike, but that seems okay. But it's really the mean that definitely doesn't look the same. So we have these trends that are now happening over here. And if I just keep hitting F2, let's see if we can come up with something else. I mean, really looking at this, and for those of you who've followed the channel a long time, you'll know that I've done things like this in the past, even to trick people when doing educational content, to show that you can easily be fooled that patterns tell you what a price is going to do next. I mean, this looks like any other chart pattern, but it's not. You watched me just randomly create this with you, and it looks like an actual chart price pattern. So the lesson from this is, if you want something to be stationary, we need its beta to be less than 1. Let me put in 0.99 here and just play around again with this alpha. There we go. 2 seems to be good. And it's starting to become more mean reverting. But if I put in something like 0.8, 40 seems to do the trick for alpha. There you go. If I have a beta of 0.8 and an alpha of 40, here you can see I have this mean reverting series here. So in order for something to be stationary, we need this here, this beta must be less than one. So when we're testing for stationarity, we're testing for this beta here to be less than one. Now, just to divert a little bit, because we haven't really covered trends yet, we've put in a constant, but we haven't put in a trend. Let's just say xt is equal to alpha plus some trend. I'll use u for trend because the t can be a little bit confusing. You might think they're the same thing, they're not. The trend is different. So what is this trend? Well, we're going to say that xt follows alpha plus some coefficient, let's say delta, times this trend over here. So here's our constant. And now here I'm going to put our trend. And to put a trend in Excel, you just put 1, 2, 3, and we can drag this down. And here is our trend over here. So now we can change our price to also include this trend, alpha plus. And in fact, let's put this delta in here. In fact, let's not use this delta. Let's use gamma, because I know when you think of delta, you're thinking of change, and we'll come onto that in other videos, the word delta. So let's use this gamma here again, just not to confuse people with terminology. And so here I'm going to put in gamma, and we'll put in 0.02 for now. And I'm just going to move these up there. And so this is going to be gamma times our trend. So let's update this formula again. So here we're going to have our constant plus gamma over there, times our trend, which is this cell here, plus then the rest of the formula. So all I've done now is I've added in another component into our model. So now I'm going to drop this down here. And all of a sudden, you can see that I've now got a trend in my price. So my price is now trending upwards. If I was to look at the, say, the mean over here versus the mean over there, you'll see that it's not the same. The average of these is not constant over time because there's a trend in my data. This is not stationary. And sometimes a data set might actually look like it's stationary, but it's actually not. And therefore, we rely on these statistical tests. We'll get into that later on. But we rely on statistical tests to go and test that, which we'll go more into when we do co-integration. So how can I get rid of this trend over here? Well, the way that we can do that, so let's say you get a price data series that's like that, is you can do it with something known as differencing. So I'm going to call this x differenced. And here, this is just going to be that number minus the number before. We're just differencing by one. Then if I go and I drag this along over here, you'll see that my price is now stationary. You can see very clearly this really does look stationary. It might not be again, there's tests to do that. There might still be some variance in the price from that, in which case we could difference the data yet again. So I could do X differenced, say, twice, and then I could do that over here. So this is another differencing. Well, the reason I'm showing you this is because of how you'll see this in the mathematics. You'll see that this variable X follows I 2 in this case, meaning it is integrated of order 2. So when we're talking about stationarity, we're also talking about this principle of being integrated. I had to difference it twice for it to be stationary. So if you have to take an asset's data and difference it twice, it's integrated of order 2. What if it's already stationary? So if we just go back a step over here, let's just forget about all that. Let's go back to our X price. Let's put this trend at 0 so that it doesn't follow any trend whatsoever. So here's our stationary series. This here is integrated of order 0. So this is a stationary series. If you see that asset X follows an integrated of order 0 type notation, then you know that it is a stationary series. If it says it follows an integrated of order 1, then you know that it's not stationary and you need to difference it once in order to make it stationary. So that's what this integration here means. So really, if I'm a trader, I do care about something that's integrated because it's easier to predict. It goes up and down and it's easier to trade. And we don't really see integrated price data out in the financial markets, not in crypto, not really anywhere. We don't really see this. And so we're hunting for something that looks like this. And therefore, we can produce something like this, not from one, but two different assets. And therein lies what co-integration is. It's looking for a way to create some kind of linear combination. And when I say linear, I mean something that looks like this, some kind of formula But except with just X in it, we have Y in it as well. So X and Y, two different assets. That when we go and model that linear combination, and we look at, say, these error terms, these market shocks from that, we can see that it follows a stationary pattern. And therefore, it is integrated or co-integrated because there are two assets. I know I'm spoiling the next video, but that's why stationarity is really important to understand. I'm going to now use the word integrated. This asset is integrated of order zero. If it was two assets making this pattern, so combining their prices in some way, where you end up with this pattern that we're looking at here, that is co-integrated. Traders care about co-integration very much often more than they care about correlation, because it's telling them that there's a relationship between two assets that does follow this stationary pattern. And that's really all co-integration is. And it can be any linear combination whatsoever. It doesn't have to be this exact thing that I model. It could be any linear combination of these two assets. If I can find an integrated series from that, then and integrated of order zero, then it is indeed co-integrated. In other words, if I can find, say, the difference between two asset prices and model that in some way, and it's stationary, in other words, the mean variance and auto-covariance is constant over time, those two assets are co-integrated. Now, I'm just going to hide this chart over here, and I'm going to prove to you around the mean, the variance, and the auto-covariance, so auto-covar, being constant over time. So let's just update this here. And here I'm just going to put in a rolling average. So let's just put in average, and that's going to be this mean over here. There's a number of ways to get variance in Excel. I think var is likely going to be the variance function there. But another way you could do it is also one you'll be very familiar with, which is standard deviation dot s, because we're dealing with the sample. And you can then just square that. That is your variance as well. In fact, let me just see here, because I don't think I've actually used var dot s before. Let me just see in Excel if that gives me the same number. And yes, it does, 0.68. Yeah, it does. Okay, so you can also use the var formula in Excel as well. And then auto covariance here, we just put in covar or covariance dot s, and array one we can put as this over here, and I'll just fix the column only. And then here I'm going to just shift it by one, and there we go. So now I have a covariance calculation. And if I drop these two formulas down as well, and then let's just format all of this to be more presentable. Let's bring up our chart here. And in fact, I'm going to keep this chart there. I'm going to put that up there for now. And I'm going to insert a new chart. So here, let's insert a chart here on our mean. So here is our mean. And you can see here, it's constant over time. Of course, it fluctuates a bit, as you can see. But let me show you the difference. When I go and say change this beta to 1, my mean is definitely not constant over time. I'll bring my alpha down just so that looks a bit more sensible. But here's my price of X. In fact, let's try and move these so that you can see them underneath one another. Here is my price of X, and here is the rolling mean over time. You can see that it is not constant over time. The minute this becomes 1, if I put this back to, say, 0.5, and this to, say, I don't know, what was it before, 100, then you can see here it's constant over time. Now let's have a look here at the variance. So if I go and shift this to pick up the variance, same thing. And here if I pick up the auto covariance, same thing. But again, what happens is when I go and say put in some kind of trend in here, then of course my mean is not constant anymore. So what happens if I go and change this beta, which again is this figure over here, to be greater than 1? Well, I can go and put this at, say, 1.2, and prices go absolutely parabolic, meaning that it is now an explosive AR1 model. This was an attempt to make a more intuitive video to try to explain integration so that in the next video, we can go deeper into testing for co-integration. I hope you enjoyed it. Until the next one, take care and talk soon.